Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to move the motion on behalf of myself and my colleagues this afternoon. As a party, we have made clear our commitment to growing the Northern Ireland economy in order to create more jobs, more wealth and more prosperity for our people. This is something which, across the chamber, we will all no doubt agree with. But how do we achieve it? It is our belief that growth in exports is an essential component for the stronger economy that we all want to see in Northern Ireland. And the benefits of it are clear. An increase in exports leads to increased sales, increased growth, increased profits. It helps to spread risks that businesses may face and helps companies with competitiveness and innovation. No one can doubt that exports and indeed all external sales are anything other than positive and beneficial for the Northern Ireland economy. Of course, Mr. Speaker, we have received good news from HMRC about the value of Northern Ireland exports in 2015. A 9.5% increase from 2014 is very positive, particularly when you consider that England, Scotland and Wales all experienced a decline during the same period. Whilst these figures for Northern Ireland are encouraging and signify that the executive strategy is working, we must not be complacent nor content with the current position. There is still huge potential for growth, and the job of the executive is to ensure that it plays its part in keeping that momentum going. As we move forward, our key outcomes in terms of exports should not only be an increase in their value, but also an increase in the number of local companies exporting. This is not only good for local companies, but also for the economy in Northern Ireland as a whole. We don't want to be over-reliant on a small number of companies for our export base. We need to see this grow and expand, but it is going in the right direction. We welcome the action that has already been taken to support these objectives. The Minister will no doubt outline his recent announcement of the Trade Accelerator Plan, which will address many of the key areas where support is needed. Mr. Speaker, at this point I want to mention some work in my own constituency that I hope the Minister will commend. Ledcom, an economic development company in Larne, supported by Mid and East Antrim Borough Council, is hosting a series of business seminars this year, and the one that is being held in January is entitled Exporting Within the EU and Beyond Post-Brexit – The Challenges and Rewards. This is exceptionally positive, as it will not only provide practical help and advice for local companies on exporting, but also recognises that new opportunities can lie ahead. So this support from the Department, from Invest, and support locally is particularly necessary in Northern Ireland, as we have the highest concentration of SMEs in the UK, and SMEs are less likely to export. I'll give way very briefly to the member for South Antrim, who must have had a very boring night on Saturday because he was tweeting me. About
No, I'm just saying about the FT. Mr. Deputy Speaker, what I would like to do is say, yes, I fully support that, but one of the things we should do is also invite the Northern Ireland Chamber of Commerce to be involved in this dialogue, because the promotion by small and medium companies, as well as by medium companies throughout Northern Ireland, by the Chamber of Commerce has been first rate. And I think that's one of the key things we need to do looking to develop exports going forward.
Member for his intervention. I don't think there should be any limits on engagement with other organisations that would have an interest in helping. Mr. Speaker, we have also, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we have also made clear our desire to see our SMEs grow, develop and upscale into larger companies. And these two issues go hand in hand. Large companies are more likely to be exporters, and companies that are exporters are more likely to grow. However, Mr. Speaker, any support should be in a targeted way rather than a scattergun approach. I was pleased to hear from the Minister when he attended the Economy Committee and said, and I quote, "We as an executive need to ruthlessly and relentlessly support those sectors and subsectors in which we are really strong." Whilst the Minister was referring to growth in jobs as a whole, I believe the same approach needs to be applied to exports. Not just that we ruthlessly export those sectors where we are strong or competitive or have the potential to be strong or competitive, but also that we ruthlessly target those markets where there is greatest opportunity for growth. Members will note from figures recently released that one of the strongest areas of growth has been in medicinal and the pharmaceutical sector. This is an area where we have had much good news, and the Minister will be aware of the success of one such company in my constituency, Terumo BCT in Larne, which he visited with me in his previous role as Health Minister, and which is a world leader in medical devices. This area and others are areas in which we can be competitive and truly first class, and they should be the focus of our energies. Having identified our key sectors, it's also important that we identify our key markets. And it's clear that the Republic of Ireland continues to be a significant trading partner, and we want to see that continue. However, figures recently released demonstrate clearly that we are seeing a change in our exporting partners. Sales to the EU and even to the Republic of Ireland are falling. This is not surprising, as they have become a smaller share of the world economy and struggle in terms of economic growth. And instead, we are seeing growth in exports to the mid-sized developing economies, to places like Turkey and Egypt, Saudi Arabia and Indonesia. And the figures there are clear for all to see. Yes, 52% of Northern Ireland exports are sold into the EU, but that's down from 59% the previous year. Trade to countries outside the EU increased by 28%, while overall EU exports dropped by 3.6%. I've been very generous. If the member's quick, I will
indeed
give away.
Would the member agree that in setting out the export figures, we need to be mindful that in fact our greatest external market outside Northern Ireland is GB, and we export 60% to GB, and then of the balance, a fraction goes to the EU?
The member must be good at reading my mind. That was the exact point that I was going to make. There is obviously a difference between exports and external sales, and of course, in terms of external sales, the UK is by far our largest market. So whilst our biggest trading partners are the rest of the UK, the Republic of Ireland and the US, which saw a massive increase of 75% last year, we need to be looking at the next tier of countries where there has been significant economic growth and room for us to be room for us to expand. Mr. Speaker, that is why we included in our motion a recognition that there are opportunities that can come from leaving the EU. Now, we all know the position of each party in the chamber, and the arguments have been made numerous times, but I would hope that everyone in this chamber, regardless of their position on Brexit, would want Brexit to be a success, and I hope that people will want us to be able to exploit the opportunities that could come from us leaving the European Union. Whilst Sinn Féin have made it clear that they would rather stay in the EU, I think in their amendment they have recognised the result, which is to be welcomed, and also that we need to focus on getting the best deal and the best outcome for Northern Ireland, especially in issues relating to cross-border trade and maintaining the common travel area. For these reasons, we are content to support the amendment if it does create a greater degree of consensus among the chamber than might otherwise be the case. Mr. Speaker, we brought forward this motion to impress upon the Minister once again the importance of exports to the local economy and the need to support key sectors and to target key markets. Additionally, Mr. Speaker, we call upon the Minister to make sure that as a devolved administration, we are to the fore at getting out there and showing the world what we have to offer. And so, in doing that, bringing greater opportunities, greater wealth and greater prosperity to everyone in Northern Ireland. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Thank you very much. I call Dr. Stephen Farrey to move amendment number one.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And it won't be lost that Mr. Lyons didn't give his support to the first amendment that we are moving today, and hasn't taken the opportunity to give his full support to the single market. And I think the business community, both here in Northern Ireland and across the UK, will take note of that and the unfortunate opportunity for the DUP and the House to unite around that does seem to be missed, though hopefully they will reconsider as we go along. At the outset, we can concur that exports are a good thing, and export-led growth is a key route through which we can transform our economy, drive up skills and productivity levels, and to enhance prosperity. And indeed, there has been some recent improvements in that regard, though we may dispute some of the underlying explanations for this. And we also concur that exports should continue to be a core element of Northern Ireland's economic strategy. In some regards, the Brexit decision is especially frustrating at a time when the peace process is well embedded and the Northern Ireland economy is addressing some of the structural reforms and really has the potential to take off and to see real results. So we're actually dragging ourselves down at a time when we're about to really lift off. Our amendment gives the Assembly the opportunity to unequivocally declare that continued participation in the EU single market is one of the most important aspects, if indeed the most important aspect, in terms of what makes the Northern Ireland economy competitive today and would maximise our competitiveness in the future. Recent export growth has reflected some microeconomic interventions around skills, innovation and the building up of capacity amongst local companies. Over the past few months, there's been a short-term boost due to the radical changes in the value of the pound in the aftermath of the Brexit vote. But cheaper exports are balanced by more expensive imports for manufacturers and consumers. And this drop in the value of the pound also reflects a drop in the value of the overall UK economy. And even the companies benefiting from the currency changes would accept that volatility in exchange rates is not healthy, and that an economy cannot be truly prosperous unless it's based upon strong, solid foundations. Therefore, the key issue for expanding our export base is accessibility to markets. There are a number of scenarios in terms of trading relationships. These range from some form of special status or special arrangement that allows us to continue to be part of the European Union, through either Northern Ireland alone or the UK as a whole continue to be part of the EU single market, passing through some form of access to single market akin to the Norway model or the less advantageous Swiss model, with the backstop of the World Trade Organization rules. Indeed, over recent days and weeks, there has been a lot of talk about WTO rules from Conservative ministers and also from some former and current Unionist politicians. This has received a strong rebuke from UK-wide employer organisations such as the CBI, who should know. Before the Brexit vote, there was a rather warped narrative that there was somehow a choice to be made between trading with the European Union and alternatively accessing the rest of the world. No doubt we will hear that reinforced today by some of the apologists for the Leave campaign in the Chamber, who will argue that the proportion of Northern Ireland exports to the Republic of Ireland and the rest of the European Union has declined, and the proportion of exports to the United States and the rest of the world are increasing, and that ergo our future prosperity lies outside the European Union. This neglects that the gap between the level of exports to Ireland and the rest of Europe, whether we're talking about services, manufactured products or agri-food, are still significantly ahead of the rest of the world. While that gap may be narrowing, the gap is nevertheless considerable, and it would be foolish in the extreme to make it more difficult for Northern Ireland companies to access what is still by far their largest non-UK market. But moreover, Europe versus the rest of the world was never an either-or choice. Rather, it is a both-and. The European Union is better placed to create new free trade agreements with other parts of the world than the UK going alone. The UK is no more likely to participate in a free trade agreement with the United States, Canada or China by going alone than going through the European Union. These deals often take years to negotiate and are rarely straightforward. TTIP is already in considerable difficulty, and even the proposed Canadian EU deal is creating controversy. Also, we see beyond our shores difficulty in terms of the TPP deal in terms of the United States. Of course, bilateral deals can be struck, such as the Swiss deal with China, which has often been cited. But worryingly, that one was concluded very much on China's terms. So if you want to simply surrender to the terms of other countries and wish to trade with us, of course we can do all these deals, but it's not necessarily in our interests. It's also worth reflecting for a moment on what this term WTO rules actually entails. It is essentially the global multilateral floor on which further progress on breaking down barriers can be built upon, or which more specific arrangements can be based. In theory, the UK can throw off its own tariff walls to imports and hope that others will reciprocate in terms of how UK exports are treated. But it is not as straightforward in practice, as many states continue to seek to protect their domestic markets, particularly and notably in terms of agricultural products and also services. It's particularly naive to think that the UK can simply lower its tariffs and expect the EU to reciprocate. To do so, especially in the absence of acceptance of the freedom of movement, would be to see the unpicking of the wider European project. We should also be clear that there's a difference in the concepts of a single market, a customs union, and a free trade zone. They are not the same, though many on the Leave side seem to think that they are. The level of tariffs is not the only barrier to trade. Transactional costs and regulatory matters and the policing of issues such as country of origin are just as important. And this is where Pacific free trade agreements, most importantly, the preference for a single market becomes much more important. And these complexities would not be addressed under WTO rules. And indeed, the further we move away from the notion of a single market, the greater the impact is going to be in terms of transactional costs and regulatory issues. All of that red tape, which I think the Leave campaign were seeking to get away from, will actually create more and more barriers for our exporters. So if we are serious about doing the best for Northern Ireland, then we need to maximise our relationship with the single market and to ideally be participants within it. Different companies and sectors within the Northern Ireland economy will have different current and potential overseas markets. And there are dangers in extrapolating from outliers. So we can also down in sight about Company X and Company Y doing good deals in the United States, and that's all to be welcomed. But let's look at the absolute statistics and see where the bulk of our trade is actually going, and will continue to go.
Would the member give way?
Yeah.
Just like some clarification on what the Alliance Amendment actually means, because it uses rather equivocal language. It talks about continuing to participate within the European single market. Does the Alliance Party want us to belong to the single market or have access to it? Because the wording used, continuing to participate, would cover both. Would you nail your colours to whichever mask it is?
Happy to clarify, and the word participate is fairly clear and unambiguous. We want to be part of the single market. That is our starting point. The notion of access to the single market is one step removed from that. And if we talk about access to the single market, then we're accepting that there will be some degree of barriers, particularly in terms of the issues around regulation and also transactional costs. So every time we take a step back, the implication for our exporters will become more severe. So it is clearly in the interest of the UK economy as a whole to maximise that engagement with the single market. The business community is loud and clear in that regard, and most recently in its warnings of the consequences of the hard Brexit. A hard Brexit is going to entail a drop in the UK's GDP and a major baseline correction in terms of our overall wealth as a nation. This logic is even more acute in Northern Ireland with our land border with another EU state, and the nature of some of our business sectors, such as agri-food, which to a large extent is organised on a north-south basis. Agri-food is also a much bigger component of our economy and faces the additional hit of confronting the highest EU external tariffs if we do leave the single market. It's also worth briefly considering our inward investment narrative. There's an air of complacency from some that, given Northern Ireland's recent strong track record and with the onset of corporation tax powers, that everything will be okay. But our success to date, and it has been a success, has nevertheless been predominantly been around attracting good quality back office functions from US companies. And our skills basis has been particularly helpful in that regard, and that type of investment can continue. But access to markets is also a key consideration for investors. Corporation tax does have the potential to be a game changer, but this is based on attracting profit centres to Northern Ireland, which are much more likely to want to have a base to sell to the single market. So at present, our investment context is characterised by risk and uncertainty, and it's important that people fully understand and recognise that. So if we are serious about an investment, it's not just about tax and talent, as is often said, it's about tax, talent and trade. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, the stakes for Northern Ireland at present are very high, and it's important that this Assembly takes the opportunity today to declare its full support for the single market. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Caoimhe Archibald to move Amendment number 2.
I welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate and to move our amendment. And I will say at the outset, I do believe and endorse the call to ensure that growing exports and enabling companies to do this should be an integral part of our economic strategy. However, I also believe that it's important to recognise the implications of the referendum result, which present companies here with significant challenges, and we must face up to this. That's not being negative, it's just being realistic. Over the past couple of months, I, like most in the Chamber, I'm sure, have had many discussions with stakeholders, business people and business representatives. The message most clearly articulated is the uncertainty following the referendum result is causing difficulties and there is a fear factor, whether we like that or not. For businesses, this makes it difficult to plan for the future and means they're less likely to invest. The Acting Director of the British Chambers of Commerce, as recently as yesterday, remarked that the uncertainty we now face is making businesses which already tend to be risk-averse even more risk-averse. Last week, we had the Chair of the Agri-Food Strategy Board before the ERA Committee, agri-food being an important sector for our economy and also involved in exports. And when asked about the opportunities being presented by Brexit for the agri-food sector, he made a salient point, stating that energy will be now spent to manage the situation we are faced with, rather than building and growing what we know today. He was subsequently asked if he thought too much emphasis was being put on negative rather than positive impacts, and responded that you have to understand the risks before you manage them, and if you work on the basis there is no threat, you won't do anything about it. So we do have to face up to the challenges businesses now face, and realise that the environment we are in does not encourage investment. We need to put in place supports to encourage enterprising behaviours. Organisations representing businesses, including the CBI and the British Chambers of Commerce, have referenced the importance of consultation with the sectors and their representatives, both in developing any priority for negotiation and also to help create stability in the short term. And I believe we have a responsibility to do that. It is important also to acknowledge the achievements of companies here. The export data that we have seen this year to June is positive news, and we should learn from what may have contributed to that. The report, which showed the 9.5% increase in exports, also included some more detailed information, which Mr. Lyons has already referenced. Highlighted there was a 74% increase in exports to the US, which is great news, and a 56% increase in what it called chemical and related products, and a 10% increase in miscellaneous manufactured products. Industries like Mr. Lyons said that have been expanding here for some time, and it's really good to see this success. The report did show the number of businesses exporting here had fallen in comparison to the same quarter in 2015. So we do have work to do in supporting businesses to explore accessing export markets. The Trade Accelerator Plan launched last month is a positive step in that regard. I believe alongside this, though, it is important to ensure there are appropriate practical and logistical supports in place, particularly for SMEs, to enable them to make the most of any export opportunities that do arise. We must also look towards supporting those same enterprises with their product and service development to ensure they are able to take up opportunities. Supports for innovation and upskilling are also important strands to any economic strategy and will underpin both general sales capabilities and export capabilities. It is also important that companies right across the north and of all sizes and sectors, including the third sector, have the same opportunities to access all of these supports and are being made aware of them. Any dissemination events taking place must include more diverse locations to ensure genuine regional balance in the delivery of events. To come to the final part of our amendment, the same HMRC report, as mentioned previously, also shows that the total of 52% of our exports go to the EU, which is still a sizeable amount worth some £3.5 billion. So remaining as part of the single market is important, and the messages coming from Westminster in this regard are not reassuring. However, the main export market for businesses here is cross-border, with over 31% of our exports worth £2.1 billion going to the south. It's absolutely vital that we continue to have unfettered access to that market, and that trade and movement continue as is. For our part in Sinn Féin, we strongly believe that the best means of achieving this is to negotiate for arrangements for the North. This is a real possibility and must be fully explored. I'm sure you'll be aware a protest took place at the weekend at border crossings across the country, calling for the Remain vote to be respected. Those present at protests represented a wide cross-section of the community, business groups, cancer support groups, disability support groups and individuals, all of whom recognise the impact any changes will have in their lives. So we are calling on the Minister to work with his counterpart in the South to ensure arrangements will be created to ensure that cross-border movement of people, goods and services will continue unimpeded. And I would urge members to endorse our amendment. We recognise, though, remaining within the European single market would achieve the aims regarding free movement and trade access, so we will be supporting the Alliance Amendment. We believe a majority support would be a strong statement from this Assembly, acknowledging the democratic will of the majority here who voted Remain. Gar Margaret.
Thank you. I call Steve Aiken.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the Alliance motion, and in order to work in such a constructive manner, I would like to point out some ideas that we can help boost trade and exports, looking for what we're looking for in Northern Ireland. But first of all, let us celebrate, because we don't do it very often, and pass on our thanks to our companies who have helped to achieve this much laudable 9.5% growth in our exports since 2015. Of particular note, as we've already talked about, is the growth in sales to the United States, which grew by 74%. The importance of our life sciences sector, which has grown its export value by 56.3%, rising to $1.5 billion. It is also pleasing to note we exported over $1 billion worth of agricultural products, and our manufacturing sector exported over $2.3 billion. Particularly looking at our pharma sector, with over 258 excellent companies, we can see, including the great company of Randox in my constituency, that a combination of a highly skilled workforce, linkages to research and development-driven universities, and a supportive financial sector and legislative system can, when properly marshalled, produce world-class and globally leading results. This has all helped Northern Ireland exports to rise to the value of $6.6 million. Indeed, as has already been pointed out, our manufacturing sectors and services sector outperform per head of population both Wales and Scotland. Although our productivity is considerably behind that of the key English regions, such as the South East, the Midlands and the Northern Powerhouse, and also, worryingly, that of the Republic of Ireland. We also have to recognise that there is considerable impact post the 31st of March 2019, in less than 29 months. And I was going to make a cheap joke here about the length of time it takes for the Office of the Deputy First and Deputy First Minister to answer an FOI request, but I'll not make that. We will be out of the EU, and it's not possible we will be worryingly out of the single European market. We note with interest that our largest export market is the Republic of Ireland. At a value of $2.1 million, it is double our next largest export destination, that of the US. It will also be post-Brexit, the UK's only land border with the EU. Indeed, when any two highly successful economic zones meet up, particularly with the EU economic zone being the world's largest economic market, and that's not going to change anytime soon, and the UK being the sixth or seventh largest economy, there is normally great opportunity. However, as many of this Assembly will be aware, currently a trade across the Irish Sea is worth some £52 billion/euros looking at today's exchange rate. That taken, $2.1 billion is slightly more than 4% of this trade. Indeed, that's probably a bit of an indictment to our failures to effectively promote this trade. And despite a plethora of initiatives, including the hard work that Invest Northern Ireland has been involved with, and to a much lesser extent that of Intertrade Ireland, we have no great push to raise this export figure to more representative figures, to say 10% of the current inter-island trade, a target of around about $5 billion. And we cannot just rest in growing trade to the Republic of Ireland, as we already stated. We must seek to grow all of our global exports over the next decade and beyond. And we need to work constructively with organisations like UKTI and other organisations to make us achieve that. In Invest Northern Ireland, we have an organisation that reported exceeded all its programme for government targets. However, in view of the overall export figures of 6.7 million, measured against an overall figure of UK exports of close on 300 billion, our exports should be in proportion at least 10 to 12 billion. Again, while measuring against Platform for Government targets, Invest NI, its performance seems impressive. We have no benchmarking against what UKTI, the Scottish Development Corporation, or even what Enterprise Ireland or the IDA achieve. These figures would be very useful for all, and we have called for these several times for Invest Northern Ireland to be benchmarked, and I would like the Minister to take that for action. So what then, going forward, would be worthwhile targets? Firstly, let us achieve 10% of all cross-Irish Sea trade, and we will need to ensure that we build as strong an economic and trade relationships with the Irish going forward as possible. Secondly, We need to grow Northern Ireland manufacturing sector to achieve 20% of our GDP and boost our exports outside of the Republic of Ireland to at least 10 to 15 billion. Our target within 10 years must be an export-driven economy that achieves, in 2016 terms, a figure of at least 20 billion in exports per annum.
I ask the member to draw his remarks to a conclusion.
This challenge, and even though with the resulting corporation tax, even that would allow Northern Ireland to be well placed to meet the challenge of the future. Northern Ireland to meet the challenges
Members,
of the forthcoming decade. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Sinead Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. As SDLP spokesperson for the economy, I stand to welcome the 9.5% increase in export growth. Before I get into my speech proper, I would, however, like to note with some amusement the secondary clause in the motion that somehow suggests the two clauses are connected and that this growth may have in some part something to do with this government, which amused me slightly. Some might even stand to argue that it happened despite this government rather than because of them, but that's it. Amongst the many figures that are presented, there is a breakdown in the overall growth, and the standout figure has to be that 56.3 growth from the chemical and related products and life sciences, which is an impressive growth in any one year. But also worthy of specific mentions, the growth in the exports to the US. And it's unfortunate there was an SDLP-UUP joint motion
order,
that did refer...
Order.
Sorry.
I said there are members, ministers and former ministers with penetrating whispers. And can I ask them to show some respect to those contributing to the debate?
Thank you, Mr. Deputy. I can assure you I'm immune. But they're certainly worth looking at, and looking at the figures that have gone through and that are very impressive. But I'd also like to note that all companies in Northern Ireland that have contributed to this, to the exporting, have really done so, and it is worthy of note that we take time to congratulate those businesses. But of course, these businesses are not asking this House or this Sinn Féin DUP government for congratulations. And if anybody was really listening to the business community at this time, they will hear that they're asking for leadership, and they're asking for an economic anchor in this pre-Brexit period. Likewise, those companies who are at this minute contemplating just the possibility of the export market, they must be supported and encouraged. Policy must reflect something that they recognise as being something they can approach and adopt for their own business. Businesses in Northern Ireland are, in my view, amongst the most versatile in the world, and have had to be, and I'm confident that they will respond to any challenges and opportunities presented to them. However, it's wholly unreasonable for anybody to expect them to respond to challenges that are unknown to them. Whilst welcoming the 9.5% growth, it's incumbent upon all of us in this House to take a much wider view of the economic performance and policies. Today's report issued by the Ulster Bank's PMI tells us that the output and new orders have stagnated during the month of September. HMRC statistics we're considering also reaffirm that our largest export market continues to be just over the ditch. It's the south of Ireland, so over the ditch and further south right across Ireland. And we must acknowledge this as a reality, and it's something we need to collectively protect. In their submission to the refocus of Northern Ireland's economic strategy, the Federation of Small Businesses quoted NISRA statistics that the EU represented 59% of our exports, with 37% of that being made in the Republic of Ireland. And during recent visits to local businesses and companies that are involved in exports, I've been told that ease of access to trade negotiations, ease of transport with no dependency on shipping, a shared cultural understanding of product and demand, and the security of working within the single European market are just a few of the reasons why the South is such a sustainable export partner. During these visits, CEOs and management teams also shared to me their thinkings on the recent referendum result. And instead of, I suppose, going into the political arena, they are focusing heavily on the real issues. One business informed me that they have considered the possible impact tariffs may have on sales, and they will consider the possibility of setting up business in the South if the burden of costs and administration is imposed on them weighs too heavily. A second export business I spoke to was less concerned about the talk of tariffs, but recognised that his particular business was heavily dependent on the free movement of people to maintain a level workforce.
Ask the member to draw her remarks to a conclusion.
Thank you. They too have also not ruled out the possibility of moving south. So I would ask this House, where does that leave our future exports when we face the real possibility of actually exporting our exporters?
Order. Thank you.
Thank you.
I call Mr. Tom Buchanan.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. One of the key strengths of Northern Ireland's economic growth is their ability to export their goods right across the globe. And while Northern Ireland may be small in stature and size and comparative economic landscape around the world, it is nevertheless punching well above its weight on the world stage. That is evident from the recorded 9.5% growth rate in exports over the past year. And indeed, the value of exports to the United States, which between June 2015 and 2016 reached almost $620 million, with evidence that the increase in the share of these exports stemmed from within Northern Ireland. And we are the only part of the UK to have recorded growth in our export markets. And this has been done in a challenging and uncertain economic climate where local businesses are keeping their eye on the ball and steadily growing their business in spite of the doom and gloom reporters prior to the referendum to leave the EU and thereafter. It was this party, the First Minister, who consistently made the economy one of the key priorities in the programme for government, recognising the importance the economy plays in growing every sector within Northern Ireland. And it is encouraging to see the many reports of local businesses which are winning contracts around the world. And it is essential, therefore, to ensure that local businesses operate in a competitive environment and are well placed to take advantage of external opportunities which face global competition. As a government, we must continue to lead from the front to show and demonstrate that local businesses can and do grow when they have an outward vision, looking outward and seizing the new opportunities coming our way. Encouraging an outward-looking vision and grasping every available opportunity is where we as a government must seek to lead our local economy. And I know that the Economy Minister has just announced a trade accelerator plan in conjunction with InvestNI to build on the growth of exports over the past 12 months, to enhance the support available to existing exporters in Northern Ireland, and for those who are perhaps considering exploring the export possibilities for their companies. Post-Brexit, Northern Ireland with the rest of the UK will enter the cusp of a new dawn for businesses, with new opportunities presenting themselves around the globe. And as this new dawn of global trade emerges, we have an entrepreneurship within Northern Ireland which I believe will rise to the challenge competing for these global contracts. And I would encourage and call on the Minister to continue on his successful track record to ensure that growing exports continue to be a key part of the economic strategy of Northern Ireland going forward. Export growth will not take place in a vacuum. It will require a combination of key stakeholders in the process, from the core research and development, which will drive the innovation of the province, to the InvestNI groups around the world, which will provide the key contacts to develop the export markets from the starting point of Northern Ireland. Everyone needs to play their part to achieve success. And we have seen this already in the steps that many businesses have already taken in launching their companies into the wider global market. It is up to the executive to build on these firm foundations, which have been forged through strategic partnerships, and to make this information readily available to the local small to medium enterprises who are considering exporting their products and their services. At this point in our history, we should rise to the challenges which are ahead, grasp the potential opportunities which present themselves, and launch into the world stage with confidence to realise the potential exports which are there for the taking. I support the motion.
Thank you. I call Conor Murphy.
Concord, And I do welcome the opportunity to speak in the debate. I also welcome the figures and the report that was done by HMRC, which shows an increase in exports from companies here. I think that's to be welcomed. I think it's encouraging, and we want to see companies grow and continue to grow, and of course continuing to export is a vital part of building up our own economy and making sure that's stronger and spread more throughout every sector of our economy. And I certainly also welcome the fact that the companies are beginning to export to newer markets as well. I think that's also very encouraging. But I think with that, the reality is this is a report which is, I suppose, set against what's happening in England and Scotland and Wales, and given that we're operating from a much lower benchmark, I think there is some perspective needed in terms of the figures, although any increase is encouraging. It's also the case that we are currently exporting to a lot of markets, even newer markets, as an EU country at the moment, based on the trade arrangements and agreements that have been made by the EU, based on the trade negotiations that have been conducted by them. Negotiations, of course, which would, if the North was to lose its status as an EU member and as a country which was part of the EU arrangements, then will be left up to an entirely new set of trade negotiations conducted from London. I think it's widely accepted that the capacity doesn't exist to have such trade negotiations. So while it's, you know, in the first reading the report is positive, and I certainly welcome that, there is a sense of, you know, getting off the sinking ship and grabbing a deck chair floating by and thinking that we're doing very, very well as a consequence of that. I think we even this morning we got some, I suppose, more sobering opinions. Certainly there was one came, I'm sure, to most of the members of the Economy Committee from the Chief Economist of the Ulster Bank, Richard Ramsey, who said that while growth in the UK economy as a whole continued to recover from the surprise vote to leave the EU in late June, the latest PMI data signals that firms in Northern Ireland are facing a much more difficult time at present. Data for August has shown a return to growth of business activity, but this has been followed in September by the month of stagnation. Moreover, local firms have yet to see a return to rising new business since the referendum, with orders broadly unchanged in the last survey period. He went on to finish by saying, the overall picture is one of firms struggling to secure new work in the wake of the vote to leave the EU, with the notable exception of those companies that have been able to capture additional export business. Recent noises that the UK government could favour a hard Brexit will likely do little to reassure local firms. We also got some feedback from the Food and Drink Association, who have yet to put together a piece on Brexit, but they said they referenced the 53 other trading partners with their preferential treatment for themselves by lower tariffs or quota from being members of the EU. And on exiting Europe, we may also exit these trade agreements, and as a result, the tariff walls will make it uneconomic to export to these markets. So I think these are sobering checks in relation to us, and I think, you know, that makes it surprising, I think, for some of us, perhaps not for some members on the opposite bench to say these things, but certainly organisations like Intertrade to declare that the business community is excited by the prospects that lie ahead. As the Chair of the Economy Committee, I've engaged with businesses big and small over the last number of months, and I can assure you that I've not met a single business that's excited by the uncertainty that lies ahead. A single business is excited by the hardening position that seems to be coming from London on a daily basis, or a single business that is excited by the plummet in sterling that seems to have happened as a consequence of that. So I think it would be much better for us if we recognised the challenges that lie ahead, and the letter from the First and Deputy First Minister, I think, did go some way along that route, that we engage with our biggest trading partners, and people have already mentioned the trade with the South, the trade with Britain itself, but also the important trade with the EU, that from our perspective we would like to see the British government respect the democratic wishes of the people here to remain. And we should seek other opportunities. I attended the launch on Friday of a report into the potential benefits economically done by an eminent economist and someone who was involved in the German reunification, the economic benefits of considering a reunification on this island. So it's a time when I think we have to be not grasping at straws and trying to present them as something significant, but actually grabbing hold of the reality of the situation that we find ourselves in, and examining all options to protect the best interests of the people that we represent.
Thank you. I call Mr. Gordon Dunn.
Deputy Speaker, and I too welcome the opportunity to speak on this motion today on what is a very important issue. Northern Ireland has a very proud rich heritage of engineering and manufacturing and processing, and has always been to the fore in innovation, research and developing new products which are in use throughout the world. InvestNI has worked with many companies in providing expert support and advice for businesses who seek to expand and grow their new products into new markets, and they must continue with this work in promoting Northern Ireland across the world. Promoting Northern Ireland around the world through trade missions is a very valuable way of selling this country and attracting FDI, and also broadening the horizons of our existing businesses, allowing them to engage with new markets through exports. There is no doubt that we have seen new markets open up in recent years, such as in the Middle East, and we must redouble our efforts to expand our sales across the globe and make Northern Ireland an even greater outward-looking global competitive economy. We too also recognise the work of Intertrade Ireland as they help to develop business on a cross-border basis with programmes of support for existing and new exporters as they seek to build customer links and help develop confidence to export new products and services. One successful recent case study is SDC Trailers in Tunbridge, who have just secured £480,000 of new business in Saudi Arabia. Ulster Carpets has also recently signed major deals in the Middle East, and Wrightbus have now been exporting their famous buses across the globe for many years. Denroy, in my own constituency of North Down, which has built an incredible reputation as a local company, is now exporting to 80 countries around the globe through its top range of hairbrushes, medical devices and aircraft components, making the Denroy Group one of our country's most successful exporters, with annual sales of more than £10 million. Having spoken to a number of small local businesses who have been to InvestNI missions, they truly value these trips, and which has allowed them to grow their export base, develop their business and ultimately create more jobs. Our thriving agri-food sector in this year of food and drink is another example of a vital sector with great potential to grow and enhance through exports. The white meat sector through Moy Park and the red meat sector through Dunbia are strong examples of local processors who continue to see growth exporting quality produce into Europe and into world markets. In a recent FASB report, they indicated that between a quarter and a third of their local members currently export, and for every business that currently exports, there is another considering exporting. This is encouraging, and as they point out, the executive, the private sector and the banking sector must focus on providing support for ambitious businesses who are keen to export and develop. That is why I welcome the Trade Accelerator Plan, which has been recently launched by our Economy Minister, Simon Hamilton, and is designed to further boost exports and support our local businesses. Despite the challenges that exist for our companies in being able to create products competitively, there is no doubt there are real opportunities for Northern Ireland to flourish and grow in the future, increase competitiveness of our economy and grow our exports now without the confines of being a member of the European Union. I support the motion, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Thank you. I call Alan Chambers.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I concur with the sentiments contained in the first sentence of the DUP motion. I can join with them in welcoming the growth in our exports announced by HMRC and applaud any efforts to increase the ability of our economy to compete in a global market. However, I would have concerns with joining the proposers of the motion in recognising the opportunities Brexit presents to improve external sales without also recognising the major dangers and threats to our exporters placed upon them by the UK taking a democratic decision to leave the EU. The HMRC figures that represent the pre-referendum situation are very encouraging, but we must not become complacent on the back of them. I'll give way later. It goes without saying that we expect the Minister for the Economy to ensure that growing exports is a key challenge for him and I am confident it is already foremost in his mind, especially given the growing suspicion that he might actually have voted to remain in the EU. Last week, the First Minister was very scathing in her comments around what she referenced as Ramoners. I'm not sure if she even glanced across the chamber, as she said it, at her Sinn Féin colleagues in the Executive, who are currently involved in High Court action on the very subject of remaining within the EU. It would be interesting to see if Sinn Féin go into a different lobby to their Executive colleagues, despite the much-talked-about non-aggression pact. I welcome, actually, the earlier confirmation from a speaker there that High Sinn Féin will indeed be voting. The DUP this evening might actually have to borrow the Sinn Féin motto of ourselves alone when the vote is called this evening. The funding cuts made to the budgets of our university, with the resulting reduction in courses in offer and the loss of EU funding in the future, will adversely impact on cutting-edge research in these places that lead to export income from product development. Is this more lost ground to be made up by new export opportunities? If we are serious about maintaining current export figures and growing them even further, we need firm commitments to invest in our transport network, our broadband network, and in providing the right training for our workforce. We must also support calls for a VAT reduction to 9% to grow even further the huge contribution tourism makes to our economy. This is a contribution that sometimes goes unrecognised. However, the most crucial part of our export future is access to the single market. Our Prime Minister is speaking about a hard Brexit, and the President of France and other significant European leaders are sabre-rattling that leaving the EU will be a bumpy ride for the UK. The First Minister claims it would be madness to show our negotiating hand at this time. Is she confident that she will actually be placed in such a situation to be playing in a game of economic poker when Brexit will undoubtedly be negotiated by those from Westminster who may have different aspirations than this executive? Now is the time for the executive to spell out loud and clear what we need from Brexit, and access to the single market should be top of any list. I'm amazed that the DUP motion makes no mention of the single market. My party document, A Vision for Northern Ireland Outside the EU, is very clear that we must have unfettered access to the EU single market. In a debate about exports, it would be remiss not to mention the efforts of local companies like Ulster Carpets, Kitchen Master and SDC Trailers, who have all recently secured export deals to the Middle East, as my colleague Gordon Dunn has alluded to, with much appreciated support from Invest Northern Ireland. We should also acknowledge the ongoing contribution to our economy from all the many exporters in every sector across Northern Ireland, like Whale Pumps and Denroy in my own constituency. I am left with the suspicion that this motion is a bit of a fig leaf for the DUP to give themselves a degree of comfort around the fact that the referendum unexpectedly gives them what they wish for, but comes with considerable uncertainty around exports in a post-EU era. The perfect outcome for Northern Ireland would be to retain all our exports to the EU, especially the Republic of Ireland, and also have the chance to explore and grow other markets. I cannot support the motion from the DUP, since it totally ignores the importance of UK access to the single market, and I will be supporting the Alliance Amendment. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
Well done. Thank you. I call Mr. Patrick McLone.
Thanks very much indeed, Mr. Deputy Speaker. And as we speak to discuss the report which we have before us here today, and I'm sure all of us in the room and heard firms that indeed have worked with the likes of SDC and that mentioned, all of us in the room want to and indeed do our best for businesses and in the circumstances that they find themselves in. We want to see them grow, we want to see them collaborate and cooperate. However, there are other aspects of this report which are indeed quite sobering for any business, that while the exports are up in from the north, that we're starting from a lower base, the number of exporters in Northern Ireland has actually decreased by 4.5%, a larger decrease than any other place within the UK. The number of importers in Northern Ireland has increased by 2.4%, but there was a fall in import value in Northern Ireland. And Northern Ireland accounts for only 2% of what's referred to as UK's exports. The largest customer is still the Republic of Ireland, which accounts for 32%, and it has been referred to already, $2.1 billion of Northern Ireland's exports. And that's where we get into the area of cooperation. That's where we get into the area of the facts that 52% of our exports actually go to other EU countries. This is a higher proportion than England, Scotland or Wales. And indeed, of that, those exports to the EU, food, beverages and agricultural produce make up 35% of Northern Ireland's exports, an extreme and very important part of our economy. Now, the key, I'm sure all of us who are speaking to businesses and listening to businesses, and that's reflected in report after report, is the pre-Brexit, what we need is stability. What we need is the fact that there's certainty about the place, but that can't be given. We've heard it referred to as the letter. The letter itself from OFM, DFM to the Prime Minister. In fact, it'd be interesting to see if there's been any response to the letter. And indeed, it has now been referred to. We've heard, indeed, one of the members referred to earlier there, that we can't reveal our negotiating hand, or the OFM-DFM can't reveal its negotiating hand because it's too early. I can understand that. That's if you had just one hand for negotiating with, or if even you agreed the cards that were in your hand for negotiating with, because one is saying, yes, this is the way to go, and others saying, yes, this is the way to go. Meantime, that certainty that's required for business is not there. And that is the circumstances you arrive at whenever you vote to pull out of something and to take us into that uncharted waters. There has been a surge, and indeed a welcome surge, in chemical and related produce, with an increase of 541 million in the subsection of medicinal and pharmaceuticals. And I too, with other members of the previous IT committee, have visited those companies, very successful companies. That accounts for the vast majority of the overall 9.5% increase. High-end produce where the investments have to be in R&D, investment in R&D, and the pivotal role that Horizon 2020 has played in that. Working with other nation states, working with other either universities or other companies in nation states to help develop those produce and draw down on the expertise in other places. Collaboration, working together. They involve, those related industries involve complex supply chains, and for this reason is potentially a sector that could be disproportionately hit by leaving the European single market. Mr. Chambers and others are absolutely right. If we don't have that access to the European single market, if we can't play a positive role in accessing that single market, it's not a good place to be. Whenever you hear those figures of the relevance of it for exports from Northern Ireland. And indeed, whenever we look at the role that the Republic plays, it remains the North's largest import partner, accounting for 27% of Northern Ireland's total imports. This was a slight decrease of 1% from the previous year, but nevertheless it's there. And that is so important, where I welcomed the recent statement that the Taoiseach set up that forum for on Brexit and around the issues associated with Brexit. And indeed a number of key stakeholders have contacted me to play their role so that we can collaboratively and positively work together in the interests of the entire island.
Thank you very much indeed. I call Jim Allister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion and to oppose both of the other amendments. The Alliance Amendment, of course, wishes to take us back. It wishes to drag us against the democratic will of the people of this United Kingdom to effectively remain within the EU. Because by saying that we must belong to, and members earlier will have heard me probe with Dr. Farrey whether it was access to or belonging to the single market, and he made it plain their amendment is geared to remain in the single market. By the act of staying in the single market, we utterly disrespect the decision of this United Kingdom to leave the EU. Because it is all the baggage of the single market which caused people to want to leave the EU. The baggage coming with its relationship with the customs union of not being able to make a single trade deal for yourself, the baggage of having to accept untrammelled free movement of labour. Those were the very things that caused the wise people of the United Kingdom to vote to leave the EU. So by saying we must remain within the single market is utterly to disrespect that decision. I'm disappointed to hear that the Ulster Unionist Party intends to vote, having said they accept the outcome of the referendum, intend to vote for this amendment from the Alliance Party. Yes?
Would the member concede that it is perfectly possible for the UK to technically leave the European Union, but nevertheless to remain part of the single market, which is in essence the so-called soft Brexit option, which is advocated by the CBI? It may not be his particular preference, but it is entirely consistent for people to make that particular argument if they wish to do so.
It's technically possible, but it totally negates the effect of leaving the EU. It leaves you in the worst possible position and leaves you shackled to all the restraints, all the bureaucracy and everything else that comes with being within the single market.
Would the member give
way? Quickly, yes.
Oh, thank you very much indeed. I'm sure the member is probably aware that if we weren't part of the single European market, trying to deal with the World Trade Organization will probably be just as bureaucratic or even harder. So would the member care to outline some alternatives, therefore, if we're not to deal with the bureaucracy of the World Trade Organization going forward in our trade discussions?
We would be master of our own negotiations. We wouldn't have to depend upon Brussels with all their attachments to endless, hideous bureaucracy to negotiate anything for us. We, in fact, would have a seat at the table, which we don't have in the WTO. The United Kingdom would have a seat at the table, and therefore we could negotiate for ourselves. We, outside the EU, can also make the trade deals. And really, the whole economic argument about leaving the EU is on the very simple premise that you want to follow where the growth is. And the growth in the world is not in the moribund EU, where the economies are failing and falling. The growth in the world is elsewhere. And yet there are those who want to tie us haplessly to the very place which in the world is failing economically, instead of lifting their eyes to the vision of what lies out there in the world where the growth is. And that's why we have to get mastery over our own trade deals and over our own regulation. Now, I've been very generous with my time. On the Sinn Féin amendment, I'm very disappointed to hear the proposer from the DUP saying he's minded to accept it, because it takes the one salient, useful thing out of the DUP motion, namely recognising the opportunities that leaving the EU presents to improve external sales. The DUP, having put that in the motion, are now prepared to see it written out of it in pursuit of a negative spin, recognising the result of the referendum, that recognising the effects that has on significant implications for businesses. But worse than that, the last phrases of the Sinn Féin amendment is about setting the ground for opt-out. It's about saying, recognising the unique circumstances on this island, to work with the Foreign Minister, or the Minister for Foreign Affairs and Trade in the Republic, to ensure cross-border trade and freedom of movement continue uninhibited. That can only happen on an opt-out. And didn't we hear the Prime Minister say there can and will be no opt-outs? We entered as one nation, we leave as one nation, and the United Kingdom government negotiate for us. So I am disappointed at the tendency towards accepting it. DUP was absolutely right not to accept the Taoiseach's invitation to whatever forum he's setting up. But they'd be absolutely wrong to accept this amendment, which is in the same tenor and towards the same direction, and takes out of their motion the very thing that's most important, grasping the opportunities to build our future where the growth is outside the EU.
Thank you. I call the Minister for the Economy, Mr Simon Hamilton, to respond, and you'll have 15 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I very much welcome this debate today and indeed the opportunity to respond to the motion and the contributions made so far. At the outset of my contribution, I'd like to thank the members who brought forward today's motion. It is right that we recognise the many successes and outstanding performances of Northern Ireland businesses. Personally, I think it is something that we should do more of in this House. I'm determined that during my time as Minister for the Economy, we will seek to celebrate success in its many guises. It is understandable that creating more and better jobs will get the bulk of our attention, but it is my intention to celebrate new contracts that see local companies exporting their goods, products and services. Examples such as the success of SDC Trailers from Tunbridge and their £480,000 contract with the Kanu Group in Saudi Arabia, and Ulster Carpet Mills' contract to provide carpet to a new five-star resort in Dubai, both announced just in the last week. And that is because growing our exports and expanding trade opportunities is absolutely crucial for Northern Ireland and central to the Executive's economic strategy. In a small region like ours, we simply cannot rely on a home market of 1.8 million people to deliver economic growth. We have to look beyond these shores. I'm absolutely delighted that the latest HMRC figures show Northern Ireland had an increase in value of 9.5% on exported goods. Significantly, we were the only part of the United Kingdom to record an increase in exports over the last year. This equates to £6.67 billion of sales on a 12-month rolling period. This is excellent news and a reflection of our increasingly global outlook when it comes to trade. Mr. Deputy Speaker, if I can pick out a few highlights from the HMRC figures. Exports to Japan were up 31% to 40 million, while sales to Australia were up by 11.1% to 80.3 million. The Americas continue to be a target market for companies from Northern Ireland, with exports recorded at £2 billion, up 49.7%. Northern Ireland manufacturing exports to the USA have been impressive, with exports increasing by almost three quarters to $1.46 billion. The most notable growth in the US market is the growth recorded in the medical and pharmaceutical sector, where product exports increased by £458 million, driven by the ongoing success of local firms like Almac and Randox. We also saw significant growth recorded in Canada, with exports reaching £372 million, an increase of £10 million, or 2.8%, largely due to increased sales in the food, medicinal and pharma sectors. Mr. Deputy Speaker, last week I travelled to the Middle East to meet influential business leaders in the United Arab Emirates and see at first hand the success of local companies in securing business in this important market. I'd like to pay tribute to the work of the excellent team of InvestNI officials who are based in Dubai, who work closely in support of companies seeking to trade in the Middle East. I was hugely impressed by the team there and in the success of Northern Ireland companies who are proving that opportunities exist in the Middle East for those who want to make their mark on the global stage. Exports to the UAE alone stand at £60 million alone in 2015-16, which is almost 15% up on the previous year. Businesses like CDE, Wrightbus, Brett Martin and Kitchen Master have set up offices in the UAE to act as a Middle East base to boost their trade opportunities in the wider region. Other companies such as Ulster Carpets, AJ Power and Malahan Engineering, to mention a few, have been successful in securing orders in the Middle East. From what I saw in the Middle East, Northern Ireland companies are more than capable of securing contracts and succeeding anywhere. The quality of products and services provided by Northern Ireland companies is second to none and is being increasingly recognised. And of course, winning new orders and contracts internationally helps grow employment locally. Growing our exports is an absolutely critical element on creating the increasingly outward-looking, globally competitive economy that I want to see Northern Ireland become. That is why I recently launched the new Trade Accelerator Plan, which offers a range of enhanced support for businesses to explore more trading opportunities outside of Northern Ireland. Mr. Regan mentioned about working with the Chamber of Commerce in Northern Ireland, and we certainly do use and will continue to use the Chamber and indeed all Chambers and business organisations to deliver our message on exports. I will be engaged in an event in early November with the Chamber of Commerce around one of their Export First events. And indeed, November is Exporting is Great Month, so there will be another renewed focus on exports in the month of November. Mr. Deputy Speaker, my role and the role of my department is to help open international doors for Northern Ireland companies and in the months ahead I intend to work in close cooperation with our network of InvestNI teams around the globe and in concert with colleagues in the new Department for International Trade to expand our exports and build on the success we've seen reflected in these latest figures. Mr. Deputy Speaker, we're on the cusp of exciting times for the United Kingdom, and I am determined to ensure that Northern Ireland is perfectly placed to take advantage of the opportunities that the years ahead will present. Aspects of the amendments to the motion, predictably given their source, focus on the impact of the democratic decision of the people of the United Kingdom to leave the European Union. It is, Mr. Deputy Speaker, hard to take seriously the predictions of doom and gloom for Northern Ireland exports that emanate from the same people who predicted immediate doom and gloom for the UK economy after June's referendum. We all know that there are challenges for the UK as a whole and Northern Ireland in particular as a consequence of Brexit. The Executive continues to work closely with local business to identify these challenges and with Her Majesty's Government to secure the best possible deal for Northern Ireland, and that includes securing the best possible deal on trade. Trade is perhaps the area where the greatest number of opportunities arise from Brexit for the UK. I want to see us to continue to trade with the European Union post-Brexit. The nature of those trading arrangements will be determined by the upcoming negotiations, but we should be using this once-in-a-generation opportunity to be forward-thinking and outward-looking in our trade ambitions. If you look more closely at the aforementioned HMRC export statistics, we see that the greatest opportunities lie beyond the borders of the EU, and that while the EU accounts for a large chunk of Northern Ireland's exports, it is not perhaps as dominant as some would have us believe. Mr. Alistair and Mr. Lyons made the distinction between external sales and exports an important distinction. Our largest market for external sales outside of our region is, of course, Great Britain. And if you take manufacturing alone, and not using the HMRC figures, but using the wider figures that InvestNI and NISRA correlate, GB manufacturing accounts for £10 billion worth of sales outside of this region. The ROI, by comparison, is £2.1 billion, so a factor of 5-1 of a difference, a point made by Mr. Alistair in his contribution. Of Northern Ireland's top 10 trading destinations using the HMRC data, 5 are inside the EU and 5 are outside. The 5 outside the EU include the US, our second biggest export destination, Canada, our third, as well as South Korea, China and Thailand. These non-EU markets account for 48% of exports, and that has been rising to our top 10 destinations. It is the trend within the figures, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that is most interesting. EU markets like the Republic of Ireland and France showed a 2.5% and 6.5% decrease respectively, while the US accounted for a staggering 74% increase over the last year. Similarly, when we look at the trend in export figures by territory, Europe's trend is downward, while the Americas and Asia Pacific are upwards. This reflects the fact, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that growth in the global economy isn't being driven by Europe. It's being driven by the rest of the world, and especially by emerging markets. Between 1996 and 2016, average GDP growth in the European Union was a lowly 1.7%. In comparison, average GDP growth in the UAE between 2000 and 2015 was 4.7%, 9.82% in China between 1989 and 2016, 5.3% in Indonesia between 2000 and 2016, and 2.72% in Brazil between 1991 and 2016. We are all well aware of the well-publicised and ongoing economic problems of the Eurozone. We are probably less familiar with the diminishing competitiveness of the EU. The recently published World Economic Forum Competitiveness Index shows that 11 of the top 20 places are occupied by non-EU states, with non-EU states taking the top 3 positions. Mr. Deputy Speaker, securing trade deals with states and regions outside the EU should be our future focus, learning the lesson of, for example, the free trade agreement between Singapore and the Gulf Cooperation Council, which has seen an around 30% increase in trade between the two since its commencement just a few years ago. Mr. Deputy Speaker, that's why our InvestNI developing markets and emerging frontier markets are dominated by destinations outside the EU. Places like Canada, the Middle East, Australia, India, Southeast Asia, South Africa and Nigeria. To reflect this, our InvestNI trade mission calendar focuses heavily on markets like Canada, China, Peru, Colombia, Mexico, the Middle East, Malaysia and Singapore over the next year. Clearly, as well as expanding our export opportunities with emerging markets, we will want to continue to trade with Europe. I was recently in Germany and found business there to be still very much interested in investing in Northern Ireland. Germany is Northern Ireland's fourth biggest trading partner in terms of both exports and imports. We import around £100 million more in goods than we export to Germany. I am confident, Mr Deputy Speaker, that a nation, a pragmatic nation like Germany, which dominates the EU, will want to ensure that future trading arrangements do not jeopardise their huge volume of exports to the United Kingdom. I will continue to work closely with Dr Liam Fox, who I have already engaged with, to ensure that Northern Ireland benefits from the new trading opportunities that Brexit will bring. Mr Deputy Speaker, I believe that the latest exports figures show that the executive strategy of focusing, having a strong focus on exports and supporting businesses to expand into new markets is working. However, we cannot stand still, and I want us to build on the success of this latest rise in exports by helping Northern Ireland to become an increasingly outward-looking trading region. There are still far too few companies exporting from Northern Ireland, and I believe that we are capable of much more. Growing our exports is a critical element of growing local business and transforming Northern Ireland into a globally competitive economy. It enables our economy to better withstand economic shocks and help ensure that everyone in Northern Ireland can both contribute to and reap the benefits from growth. To do this, we must strive to be more competitive in everything that we do. Enhancing our competitiveness is an important element in supporting long-term economic growth. Being better than before is obviously laudable, but I make no apologies for believing that we should not be striving to be the best export, exporter amongst comparator regions. We need to know that we are forging ahead of other similar small advanced economies, and this is the true measure of competitiveness. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I believe that the opportunity exists now to transform our economy. We have come through one of the worst recessions on record. We are forging ahead with plans for the introduction of reduced corporation tax, and we are on the cusp of an exciting new era for the United Kingdom. When and where doors are open to new trading relationships and emerging markets, Northern Ireland must be ready to seize the opportunities. My department's Export Matters Action Plan sets out our ambitions for growing exports with three main targets, namely to increase the volume of external sales by 80% by 2025, to increase the number of our companies engaged in external sales to 16,000 by 2025, and to increase the geographical diversity of our export markets. Key to achieving these targets is enabling those companies already active overseas to be more successful and supporting those not yet selling overseas to become export active. Creating the kind of economy we aspire to requires partnership between the public and private sectors. Our role in central and local government is to provide the framework and conditions which enable our companies to flourish and grow. For those already exporting, InvestNI is increasing its support for market visits to ensure businesses are able to strengthen existing relationships through the Trade Accelerator Plan. This support will include assistance for more country visits and access to InvestNI's team of advisors based in countries around the world. For those yet to take the first step and begin exporting, InvestNI is enhancing its programme of support for first-time exporters looking at our closest markets in Great Britain and the Republic of Ireland. Mr Deputy Speaker, I want to conclude by again recognising and celebrating the export success of local companies over the past year, as witnessed in these latest figures. Northern Ireland has fantastic companies across all sectors producing goods and services of the highest quality that can compete with businesses anywhere in the world. Globally, there are huge opportunities, and we should have the ambition, confidence and self-belief to grasp these. Mr Deputy Speaker, as we strive to become a globally competitive economy, I want to assure the proposers of the motion and the House as a whole that it is in my role as Minister for the Economy, I will do all in my power to assist our exporting companies to succeed internationally and deliver for the people of Northern Ireland. Mr Deputy Speaker, I found the debate today to be useful, and I have no hesitation, therefore, in supporting the motion. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Mr John O'Dowd to wind on Amendment number 2. 5 minutes.
5 minutes, Mr Deputy Speaker. Okay. Thank you very much. Who would argue against supporting a motion which congratulates our companies for raising their game in relation to exports? Of course you would. Well done to everyone involved, well done to all those who have supported them, and I wish them continued success going into the future. But wishing them success isn't the same as enabling them to have success. And we are actually restricting the potential of local companies to export. And several members, particularly those who favour leaving the EU, We're keen to talk about where our local companies are currently exporting to and how they're exporting outside the European Union, which begs the question, we're still members of the European Union. How are our companies exporting to countries beyond the European Union? To listen to some of those who support, I'm not necessarily saying in this chamber, but listening to some of those who support Brexit, as it's become known, you would think that we were going to set a sail voyagers to discover new lands. Well, here's the newsflash. The European Union have already discovered them and are already trading with them and already have trade agreements with them. And I'm going to go through several of the countries which were mentioned. I'll not know. Turkey. One member mentioned Turkey. Our trade has increased with Turkey. He failed to mention that Turkey is a member of the EU Customs Union. He failed to mention that Turkey pays into the EU budget for the privilege of being a member of the EU Customs Union. Mr. Alistair described the EU Customs Union as something akin, he didn't use these words, but to the devil, a barrier to trade. Guess what? We're trading with Turkey. And why are we trading with Turkey? Because they're members of the EU Customs Union. Other members then went on to rightly talk about our increased trade to the United States of America. How are we trading with the United States of America? Through trade agreements negotiated with the European Union and others. And I will quote, there is currently negotiations around a new trade agreement. There is currently negotiations around a new trade agreement, but we are trading with them under the basis of agreements. And I would like to continue without being constantly interrupted.
Order. It's clear the member has no words to give way.
And the comment from the EU Commission in relation to the relationship with the United States of America, and I quote, the EU and the United States have the largest bilateral trade relationship and enjoy the most integrated economic relationship in the world. What did President Obama say to the people in Britain when he visited about new trade agreements with Britain? Get to the back of the queue. That was his comment. Now, how is that going to help our local exporters move forward? Oliver Hart has just been awarded the Nobel Prize for Economy. An economist, Nobel Prize winning economist, just awarded it. His comments on Brexit. The EU is Britain's most important trade partner. Trade barriers with the EU would rise, and this will hurt Britain's investment and growth. Move on to Saudi Arabia. How are the companies exporting trailers to Saudi Arabia? How is the company in my own constituency providing carpets to Saudi Arabia? Through the European Union's Gulf Cooperation Council, EU's largest export in that region. So how are these companies doing this? They're doing it through current EU arrangements with Saudi Arabia and other Gulf states. How are we trading? And the minister mentioned Japan. Japan is the second biggest trading partner in Asia, next to China. Who with? The EU. Australia. Trade is conducted with Australia through the EU-Australia Partnership Framework. The minister mentioned South Korea. Again, I quote from the EU Commission. 2016 marks the fifth anniversary. Just so members hear it. 2016 marks the fifth anniversary of the EU-South Korea Free Trade Agreement. Lo and behold, the EU has discovered all these trading partners, which those who support Brexit and those who believe they're going to support our exporters are going out to find. Folks, well, we are up here. I'll give way, yes.
Point of view from people in this chamber to say, I voted against leaving the European Union, but at the same time saying I can recognise that there are opportunities that can come from leaving the EU. Because that's the problem that we have seen here in the chamber today. People want to rerun the referendum rather than say, this is where we are, let's get on with it and exploit the opportunities.
The member
I believe that the Remain vote should be respected here and that we should remain members of the EU. I have read out to you today a list of trade agreements that already exist with companies which other members in this chamber, which companies and other members, among members in this chamber have said we should trade with. We are trading with them. We're trading with them through the EU. Once we leave the EU, we have to rewrite and renegotiate every trade deal there is. Is that going to help our companies export or hinder our companies' export? I believe it will hinder our local companies in their export progress. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I call Mr. Stuart Dixon to wind on amendment number one, and again you have up to five minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Can I first of all thank my colleague Stephen Farry for bringing forward this amendment today and for the reference which he has made to the importance of the single market in that, and indeed to colleagues in the Chamber from Sinn Féin, the Ulster Unions and the SDLP who have indicated their support for that amendment today as well. This is about sending out, Deputy Speaker, a very clear signal that unites both pro- and anti-Brexiteers in this debate, that the single market is vitally important to the future success, not only of Northern Ireland, but to the United Kingdom. This isn't about the specifics or the nuts and bolts of how all of that is to be achieved. Those are matters for which the Prime Minister and hopefully this executive and the Office of First and Deputy First Minister will be involved in as these matters evolve. It's clear that the referendum has to be accepted, and we cannot have a rerun of the question that was put to the country earlier this year. But there does have to be a democratic grip on the process. It's quite clear the Prime Minister is very unkeen to let go of the undemocratic grip that she has on the process by so far refusing even to allow her MPs to debate the matter. But that debate will have to take place not only in Westminster, but in this place and in Scotland and in Wales as well. But today is about sending out a strong signal that the European single market is important to the future of the United Kingdom, it's important to the future of Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. Much has been said in the debate this afternoon about improved exports, and while all of that is true, a stable pound is the most important thing that we need for our economy, and a volatile pound is not what is needed for this economy and is what will ultimately lead to a very volatile market situation. It's important to say that while we have and we all can laud those improvements in exports, that the widening deficit between imports and exports in the United Kingdom is the figure that we should be keeping an eye on, which has reached an eye-watering £4.7 billion. 40 years of trading relationships, building trusts, building exports, building stability, and building beyond, as other speakers have said, is the legacy of the EU and what it has done in terms of trade negotiations. Export figures are to be welcomed, but as I've said, the trading deficit is what we need to keep our eye on. Today is about the economics of Remain in the single market. The politics and the future of the UK and the EU is a debate for another day. Sadly, for every positive export story, there are also negative stories. Recently, listening to lorry drivers in the constituency of East Antrim, as well, they are telling me of their fears and their concerns as owner drivers and as small companies who have to drive across Europe, and the red tape and additional problems that they are going to face if indeed they have any business to do on behalf of their clients in a single market in the future. Access to the single market is what this motion is about. It's what this motion should always have been about today. And it is somewhat disappointing that the DUP failed to include that in their motion. Can I ask, indeed, Mr. Speaker, Deputy Speaker, that Mr. Alistair made reference to the benefits of deals with the World Trade Organization. He may very well be true, but the reality is the word is negotiation. It's a two-way street. And those negotiations are currently undertaken on our behalf by key and skilled negotiators, which we do not have in the United Kingdom, which the government has admitted it doesn't have in the United Kingdom, and those skills will have to be built up over a period of time.
Would the member give way?
Yes.
Would the member recognise, and I think this is probably the key aspect of difference in terms of the debate in the chamber. That the fact is that we're actually more likely to see the opening up of those different markets around the world on the floor of the current WTO rules in the United States, in Canada, with China, if we're part of the single market, and that they're much more likely to do a deal with the European Union than they are to do a deal with the UK in isolation.
I entirely agree with
Members
the member.
Minute.
Thank you. I entirely agree with the member, and indeed none of those nations or states that he has made reference to the best of my knowledge, indicated at any time that it would be better for the United Kingdom to be out of the EU and out of the single market. In fact, it is my understanding that every single one of them wants us to remain in the single market and would have preferred that we remained in the EU. No. Certainly not. It's perfectly important to note that it is important for us to continue to negotiate with those states within the European Union and to maintain our links with the single market. Finally, Mr. Speaker, can I ask the Minister or say to the Minister directly, while he has clearly set out a very cogent argument in terms of where we need to be going now and in the future in terms of our trade and exports for Northern Ireland, and I don't necessarily disagree with what he's saying, given the situation that we find ourselves in, but can the Minister point to any trade or employers organisation in Northern Ireland that actually agrees with his analysis?
Member's time is up. Thank you. It occurs to me that very few of us mind Germany doing well, as long as it's not in Hanover tomorrow night. Now, before I put the question on Amendment Number 1...
Sorry.
We have not yet heard from the winder of the main motion. We must have a story from Mr. Story. Mr. Mervyn Story.
I've never had an introduction like that before in this House. I would start, Mr. Deputy Speaker, by saying a word of congratulations to all who have taken part in this debate this afternoon. And for one thing, it is the tone and the tenor of what it is we have said. Because let's remember, while we do clearly have our differences, the business community out there is wanting us, as their public representatives, to do the very best for them. And they do get frustrated with the cheap political point scoring, with just the jibe comments. And sometimes that masks for us all, because we all have organisations and companies and families who are involved in all of these businesses, and they want us to see us doing the very best. But here is where the starting point is. Referendum clearly indicated what was the will of the British people. And I have to say I'm disappointed in a party that was once shackled to the Conservative Party, that once was quite happy to bring David Cameron here, and now all of a sudden they want to distance themselves from the current Conservative government. But however, and whatever whatever the politics of that may be, we must respect, and you know, for other parties in this chamber who have lectured us for many, many years about recognising the democratic process, then all of a sudden when they lose the vote, then they say, oh no, but it was only Northern Ireland, we were only talking about Northern Ireland. It's very clear when I went to vote what it said. I was voting as a citizen of the United Kingdom. So let's ensure that that is said. Also, let me say that in terms of the competitive nature of Northern Ireland, well, let's be very clear. We saw that at the weekend. Northern Ireland clearly can win on the pitch. And as the Deputy Speaker has said, we wish them well for their endeavours tomorrow night in Germany. And we trust that they have a good result. And what Saturday evening proved to us again is that there is that competitive edge and drive and fervour in Northern Ireland companies. And what we've heard in this debate today, Mr. Deputy Speaker, is a range of comments and views in terms of where we are at in terms of our economy. I commend my colleague, Mr. Gordon Lyons, for opening on the debate in relation to the motion, and he emphasised the commitment to growing the economy. And I think that is what we all collectively want to see done. That's what we all, if we are worth the salt of any of our occupations in this house, is to ensure that companies in all our constituencies, and we've had a range from hairbrushes that my colleague Mr. Dunn was extolling the company in his own constituency, and you can see by the look of him, he uses one pretty regularly, to a variety of other businesses. And I'm not going to let Northantrim, obviously Right Bus has been referred to, and we're rightly proud of Right Bus right across the world in terms of what it does for Northern Ireland's manufacturing and what it does for the reputation of manufacturing in the United Kingdom. But also, just last week, I had the great opportunity to go with the First Minister to visit Christie's Direct in Ballymoney, a company which is going beyond the bounds of its ability to be able to sell its products, a company based in Northern Ireland that has become the second most visited website in the world, second to Walmart, and it's based in Ballymoney. I think that's a great credit to a local company, a local business that is taking on the world stage in terms of the internet, a very, very challenging set of circumstances. But let me turn to some of the comments. Mr. Farrey obviously made reference to a number of comments, and he made reference to that the referendum was frustrating. Well, it may be frustrating, but that's what it was. But then he went on to say about dragging ourselves down. Who is it that is dragging ourselves down? It is the constant, relentless naysayers and doom and gloom merchants who, on one hand, say, oh, we have these wonderful companies, and look what they do, and how well they perform, and the great products they have. But it's all doom. We're all going to head to abyss because of this awful decision.
Would the member agree with me that the reason why we hear some of these comments from other parties is because they don't actually want Brexit to succeed? They want to be proved right, and they don't want to see the success that we're having in our economy.
I think there may be an element of that. I think as well it is also a case where they want to have the best of both worlds. But the reality for us is we will leave the European Union. That's the reality for us as a result of the decision. Now we have to ensure that in those negotiations, and if you listen to the comments by Liam Fox, I believe that he is intimating, while the negotiations haven't yet started, that there will be those countries who will want to come to do business with the United Kingdom. There are those companies who want to ensure that the opportunity to do business with the United Kingdom is still in place and enhanced and is benefited from. So I think that is where we need to focus our attentions. And I go back to the comment of Dr. Farrey about dragging ourselves down. What we have now done is unshackled ourselves, because not one member, or not many members, have reminded this House of the imposition of rules and regulation and red tape that has been a hindrance to business, that has, in fact, has been an impediment to us making progress. Yes, I'll give
way. Could you tell me what, under which trading scenario he visits that there will be no rules and regulations? And does he actually recognise that if he follows through on some of his own policy, his own party's policies around, for example, immigration, he's actually asking business to take on more regulations in terms of actually checking people's right to work in the country?
I think what we have never said that all regulation is bad, but what we have said is the imposition of unaccountable bureaucrats in Brussels telling businesses in Northern Ireland and the United Kingdom how they should best operate when they themselves are the worst. Let's remember, this is an organisation which can't even balance its budget. This is an organisation which has the most bloated bureaucracy of any democratic, and I wouldn't even call it democratic. The member wants to I'll give way to my colleague in North Antrim. No, not the one from not the one from South Antrim.
Would the member agree that one of the greatest punitive impositions of the single market is that its hideous regulations apply to every company, whether they're exporting or not, and therefore every company in the United Kingdom is pulled down by regulations that are of no relevance to them in the sense that they're not even going to export. And by escaping the single market, we escape that hideous burden.
And the member makes the point and makes it well. And 5% of companies export and they have to be subject to 100% of the rules and the regulations. And so therefore, I think that yes, I'll give way.
Mr. Deputy Speaker, I think the key here is the World Trade Organization. If anybody here thinks for one moment that the World Trade Organization is going to be easier to deal with than the EU, I think they're very, very sadly deluded. What we need to be able to do is get the best trade deal that we can. And we must be able to do that by able to get the most sensible deal we can, whether it's with the EU or going forward.
I think that the member misses the point too in relation to the fact that we limit our own ability in terms of bilateral trade agreements. Like it seems to be that you must always accept the lowest common denominator in terms of the plan for the future, and that there is no ambition. There's certainly very little ambition. I didn't see much ambition in the 10-point plan that was produced by the Ulster Unionist Party, and I see my other North Antrim colleague has left the chamber. Maybe he has left because he knows that in terms of what his stance was in regards to the referendum and what he was telling the farmers and the voters in North Antrim. So at least we have now raised the temperature of debate in the House. But let us
order. Members, about 10 seconds.
It was all going well until I stood up. However, what I want to say to this House is, let's make Northern Ireland work. And I believe that unshackled from the European Union and given the negotiation of Her Majesty's Government, that we have a bright future,
Member's time.
A future that is to the benefit of all our citizens.
Member's time is up. I'm rather glad I let him in. The House is in good tune. Now, before I put the question on Amendment number 1, I would remind members that if it is made, I will not put the question on Amendment number 2. The question is that Amendment number 1, standing in the names of Dr. Stephen Farry, Mrs. Naomi Long, Mr. David Ford and Mr. Stuart Dixon, be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
No.
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 The House will divide. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Members will resume their seats. Order. Order. Members, take your seats, please. Can I ask members to take their seats? Okay. Okay, the question is that amendment number one, standing in the name of Dr. Farrey, Mrs. Long, Mr. Ford and Mr. Dixon be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Very close.
No.
Desperately close. Okay, do we have tellers? Tellers, please. Order. 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 Ask the members to resume their seats. Now, tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes, Stuart Dixon and Kelly Armstrong. Tellers for the noes, Gordon Lyons and George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Thank you. Order. Members, resume your seats, please. Order. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 76 members voted, 46 members voted aye, 30 members voted no. Amendment 1 is therefore agreed.
The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Unfasten the doors. And as I indicated, Amendment 2 will now not be voted on. Question is then that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
The order, I've been advised by the party whips in accordance with Standing Order 27(1)(a)(b) that there is agreement that we can dispense with the 3 minutes and move straight to the division. So we now call for the tellers. Do we have tellers? Order. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes, Stuart Dixon and Kelly Armstrong. Tellers for the noes, Gordon Lyons and George Robinson. To the lobbies, the Assembly will divide ayes to my right, noes to my left. Order. Members, resume your seats. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 76 members voted, 46 members voted aye, 30 members voted no. The motion, as amended by Amendment 1, is carried.
Thank you. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Unfasten the doors. Item 6 on the order paper, the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned.